Our genetic information is encoded by the DNA double helix. When DNA is read or transcribed, one strand of the double helix serves as a template strand. The specific order of the four bases encodes genetic information and serves as the blueprint for our genetic makeup. Each rung of the DNA ladder is called a base pair. In total, the human genome consists of about 3 billion base pairs and encodes about 30,000 genes. A full copy of the genome is found in the nucleus of every cell. Each cell has the same 23 pairs of chromosomes. In our cells, DNA is wrapped around proteins like thread around a spool. The structure that we see here is called a nucleosome, which consists of the DNA helix tightly coiled around histone proteins. Histones have long extensions, called histone tails, which protrude from the nucleosome core. As we will see, modifications to both the histone tails and the DNA itself are indicative of whether DNA is active or not, and this is controlled by epigenetics. Epigenetics refers to processes that instruct our cells how and when to read the DNA blueprint. This is marked by the change in histone tail modifications, the arrival of structural proteins which help condense the DNA, and DNA methylation. The inactive chromosome is more tightly bound and condensed than the active form. This means that the DNA is less accessible to molecules involved in transcription. Ultimately, this compact version of the chromosome is unable to be transcribed and is therefore silenced. The active chromosome has a dispersed or open appearance, often described as resembling beads on a string. Molecules involved in gene transcription can access open DNA. Transcription factors can bind open DNA. These proteins are important in transcription initiation. They can recruit other proteins, such as histone-modifying enzymes. A new modification is added to a histone tail. Open DNA is more loosely bound to histones, which allows for nucleosome disassembly. Nucleosome remodelers can also access the active X chromosome. These proteins slide the nucleosome along DNA. Ultimately, these changes open the DNA and allow RNA polymerase, the DNA reading enzyme, to access and transcribe DNA into messenger RNA.
The assembled factors trigger the first phase of the process, reading off the information that will be needed to make the protein. Everything is ready to roll. 3, 2, 1, go. The blue molecule racing along the DNA is reading the gene. It's unzipping the double helix and copying one of the two strands. The yellow chain snaking out of the top is a copy of the genetic message, and it's made of a close chemical cousin of DNA, called RNA. The building blocks to make the RNA enter through an intake hole. They are matched to the DNA, letter by letter, to copy the A's, C's, T's, and G's of the gene. You are watching this process called transcription in real time. It's happening right now in almost every cell in your body. The job of this mRNA is to carry the gene's message from the DNA out of the nucleus to a ribosome for production of the particular protein that this gene codes for. There can be several million ribosomes in a typical eukaryotic cell. These complex catalytic machines use the mRNA copy of the genetic information to assemble amino acid building blocks into the three-dimensional proteins that are essential for life. Let's see how it works. The ribosome is composed of one large and one small subunit that assemble around the messenger RNA, which then passes through the ribosome like a computer tape. The amino acid building blocks, that's the small glowing red molecules, are carried into the ribosome attached to specific transfer RNAs. That's the larger green molecules, also referred to as tRNA. The small subunit of the ribosome positions the mRNA so that it can be read in groups of three letters known as a codon. Each codon on the mRNA matches a corresponding anticodon on the base of a transfer RNA molecule. The larger subunit of the ribosome removes each amino acid and joins it onto the growing protein chain. As the mRNA is ratcheted through the ribosome, the mRNA sequence is translated into an amino acid sequence. There are three locations inside the ribosome, designated the A site, the P site, and the E site. The addition of each amino acid is a three-step cycle. First, the tRNA enters the ribosome at the A site and is tested for a codon-anticodon match with the mRNA. Next, provided there is a correct match, the tRNA is shifted to the P site, and the amino acid it carries is added to the end of the amino acid chain. The mRNA is also ratcheted on three nucleotides, or one codon. Thirdly, the spent tRNA is moved to the E site, and then ejected from the ribosome to be recycled. Using computer animation based on molecular research, we are now able to see how DNA is actually copied in living cells. You are looking at an assembly line of amazing miniature biochemical machines that are pulling apart the DNA double helix and cranking out a copy of each strand. The DNA to be copied enters the production line from bottom left. The whirling blue molecular machine is called helicase. It spins the DNA as fast as a jet engine as it unwinds the double helix into two strands. One strand is copied continuously and can be seen spooling off to the right. Things are not so simple for the other strand because it must be copied backwards. It is drawn out repeatedly in loops and copied one section at a time. The end result is two new DNA molecules. In this animation, we'll see the remarkable way our DNA is tightly packed up so that 6 feet of this long molecule fits into the microscopic nucleus of every cell. The process starts when DNA is wrapped around special protein molecules called histones. The combined loop of DNA and protein is called a nucleosome. Next, the nucleosomes are packaged into a thread. The end result is a fiber known as chromatin. This fiber is then looped and coiled yet again. Familiar shapes known as chromosomes, which can be seen in the nucleus of dividing cells. Chromosomes are not always present. They form around the time cells divide when the two copies of the cell's DNA need to be separated.
DNA in each one of your cells is just 2 nanometers across, but around 30 to 40 million nanometers long. To keep DNA organized and regulate access to the genetic code, it is wrapped around structural proteins to form nucleosomes, which are then further organized into fibers called chromatin. The chromatin fibers are packaged into gigantic molecular structures called chromosomes. We are now pulling away from a chromosome out through a nuclear pore, which is a gateway through the nuclear membrane. We are zooming back to reveal a cell about to undergo mitosis. The nuclear membrane breaks down, releasing the chromosomes. Chromosomes are arranged in the middle of the cell before being pulled apart with identical sets of DNA going to each side. The cell then splits down the middle, creating 2 new daughter cells. This visualization isolates a single chromosome at mitosis. The chromosome contains 2 identical copies of DNA. Each DNA molecule is packaged up into one of the sausage-shaped chromatids. Sticking out from either side are microtubule fibers from the mitotic spindle used for orienting and guiding the chromosomes to their correct positions. The red region is the kinetochore, which works as the interface between the microtubules and the chromosomes. The kinetochore is one of the largest and most complex molecular mechanisms inside living cells, with multiple functions to perform. The kinetochore is central to the movement of the chromosomes and is able to hang on to the dynamic ends of the microtubules. It is also a mechanical tension sensing system, which is able to feel if everything is correctly attached and positioned. It is also a stop signal broadcasting system, sending out chemical signals to the rest of the cell about whether it is ready to undergo separation of the chromosomes. This kinetochore has sensed that the tension is just right and the chromosome is correctly positioned and attached. The last little bit remaining red is the stop signal broadcasting system. It is carried away by a dynein motor, walking down the microtubule away from the kinetochore. These are molecular motors involved with a directed transport along the mitotic spindle. The orange proteins walking to the left are kinesins, molecular motors carrying proteins on their back. Striding from the kinetochore on long molecular legs are dynein, carrying the stop signal broadcasting system. When all the kinetochores are ready, the cell transitions into the anaphase stage, with the chromatids pulled apart to the opposite poles of the cell,